My name is Dr. Jan Epper-Jesse. I'm a resident in obstetrics and gynecology at Duke University, and this presentation is about preterm labor. For this presentation on preterm labor, there are four learning objectives. The first is to learn the definition of preterm labor. The second is to learn risk factors for preterm labor, and also to appreciate the morbidity and mortality associated with preterm labor. The third is to learn how to clinically evaluate for preterm labor, including the negative predictive value of fetal fibronectin. The fourth is to learn how to clinically manage preterm labor. This includes administration of corticosteroids, tocolytics, antibiotic prophylaxis for group B streptococcus, and treatment of risk factors. Preterm labor is defined by regular, organized contractions occurring before 37 weeks of gestation and accompanied by cervical change, including dilation, effacement, or both. Both contractions and cervical change must be present in order to have a diagnosis of preterm labor. If a woman just has contractions with no cervical change over several hours, this is not considered preterm labor, but rather preterm contractions. The clinical management for preterm labor versus preterm contractions is quite different. Essentially, for preterm contractions, the management is supportive care, whereas with preterm labor, active management is called for. We will discuss the management of preterm labor in more detail later in this presentation. There are several risk factors for preterm labor. These include multiple gestations, like twins or triplets, history of previous preterm birth, bleeding after the first trimester, shortened cervical length, African American race, pelvic or systemic infections, uterine anomalies, for example, a unicornuate or bicornuate uterus, persistent uterine contractions over a long period of days to weeks, smoking, maternal stress, and depression. With respect to vaginal infections, it is important to know that bacterial vaginosis is associated with preterm labor. However, the relative contribution of this condition to preterm labor remains controversial, especially in women with no other risk factors. Preterm labor is associated with multiple neonatal morbidities that pose serious challenges for neonatal intensive care units. These morbidities include respiratory distress syndrome, intraventricular hemorrhage, bronchopulmonary dysplasia, patent ductus arteriosus, necrotizing enterocolitis, neonatal sepsis, and retinopathy. Long-term morbidities are also a serious problem. These include chronic lung diseases, cerebral palsy, vision and hearing impairment, and other CNS defects. Extremely preterm birth is defined as birth between 22 and 25 weeks. Most neonatal intensive care units provide intensive care routinely at 24 weeks. Moderate to severe disabilities occur in 50% of extremely preterm fetuses. Moreover, survival at 22 weeks is about 21%. At 23 weeks, it is about 30%. At 24 weeks, 52%. And at 25 weeks, 76%. Late preterm birth between 34 and 36 weeks of gestation accounts for 9.1% of all deliveries in the United States. It is also associated with an increased risk of respiratory morbidity, namely RDS, transient tachypnea of the newborn, pneumonia, and respiratory failure. Imagine that you are in the labor and delivery unit of your hospital, and a woman presents to you at 33 weeks of gestation, complaining of crampy contraction pains. You immediately think of preterm labor versus preterm contractions. How will you go about evaluating this patient further? First, you must start with the history. You ask about the nature of the contractions, namely the intensity and the frequency, and when the contractions started. Remember, labor contractions become increasingly painful over time and occur with a rhythmic regularity at least every 5 minutes, if not more frequently than that. You also ask about any spotting of blood or bloody mucus on her undergarments, otherwise known as bloody show, which is related to cervical softening and effacement. Then you move on to the physical exam. First, you introduce a speculum into the vagina and visualize the cervix. You inspect the cervix looking for dilation, lesions, or bleeding. If the patient is at less than 34 weeks gestation and has not had intercourse, cervical exam, tampon, or vaginal ultrasound in the last 24 hours, you would do a fetal fibronectin test. This is done by placing a swab in the posterior fornix of the vagina for about 10 seconds and then sending the swab to the laboratory for analysis. If you suspected vaginal infection, you would do a wet prep to rule out bacterial vaginosis, yeast, or trichomonas. You would also obtain cervical, gonorrhea, and chlamydia cultures and a urine culture. You would then move on to the digital cervical exam. Remember, when you do this, to measure the dilation of the internal os as opposed to the external cervical os. In your evaluation, you are constantly aware of the output from the electronic fetal monitor and the maternal tachometer. These allow you to objectively document fetal heart rate patterns and the frequency of maternal contractions. If your patient is contracting regularly and the fetal heart rate pattern is reassuring, you will recheck the patient's cervix in a couple of hours to see if it has become more dilated or effaced. If it has and the contractions persist, your patient is indeed in preterm labor. Let's return to talk about the fetal fibronectin test. Let's say you have a patient at 33 weeks who presents complaining of contractions. If the fetal fibronectin test is negative, there is a 69 to 92% chance that the patient will not go into preterm labor in the next 1 to 2 weeks. Or, in other words, a negative fetal fibronectin is reassuring in that your patient probably won't go into preterm labor. However, the positive predictive value of fetal fibronectin is less than 20%. So, from that perspective, a positive fetal fibronectin really doesn't tell you with much certainty if your patient really is in or will go into preterm labor. The important point to remember is that fetal fibronectin's clinical value is in its negative predictive value. Furthermore, the test will be contaminated and not useful clinically if the specimen is contaminated with blood, semen, gel, or if there is a history of any foreign object in the vagina within the last 24 hours. Finally, fetal fibronectin is only performed between 24 and 34 weeks of gestational age. Now let's turn to the management of preterm labor. There are four basic things to keep in mind. Number one is corticosteroids, such as betamethasone or dexamethasone. If your patient is between 23 and 34 weeks of gestation, you will give steroids. At Duke, we give betamethasone 12 milligrams intramuscularly every 24 hours for a total of 2 doses. This is the most beneficial intervention in preterm labor because it reduces the incidence and severity of respiratory distress syndrome, intraventricular hemorrhage, and necrotizing enterocolitis. At places like Duke, studies are also being done to assess the benefit of giving steroids for late preterm labor after 34 weeks, but this is not the standard of care at this time. Number two is tocolytics. A tocolytic is an agent that aims to stop uterine smooth muscle contractions. The primary purpose of giving a tocolytic in the setting of preterm labor is to abate the contractions enough to allow the administration of the full steroid course and circulatory transport of the steroids to the fetus. Ideally, tocolysis can prolong the pregnancy for up to 2 to 7 days in order to achieve these goals. There are several tocolytics available, but none of them are truly ideal in terms of clinical efficacy or their side effect profile. The agents include magnesium sulfate, nifedipine, which is a calcium channel blocker, indomethacin, which is a prostaglandin inhibitor, and terbutaline, which is a beta mimetic. Of note, multiple tocolytics for the purpose of prolonging pregnancy are not proven to be beneficial. Number three is treatment of risk factors for preterm labor. If the patient has a urinary tract infection, bacterial vaginosis, or a sexually transmitted infection such as chlamydia, gonorrhea, or trichomonas, you would treat it. Finally, number four is group B streptococcus prophylaxis. If your patient is in preterm labor and her group B streptococcus status is unknown, you would obtain cultures using a vaginal rectal swab and then start IV penicillin. If the cultures for GBS come back negative, or if the patient has recent negative cultures on record, then there is no need for antibiotic prophylaxis and they can be stopped. If contractions abate spontaneously or with tocolytics, or the cervix does not change any further, the patient is no longer in active preterm labor, and antibiotics for GBS prophylaxis can be discontinued.